Hi, and welcome to Mod 3, Chapter 3, Anticipating Human Behavior in Disasters. So, really, in order to react to a disaster effectively, it is imperative that you understand people's misconceptions about human behavior. A lot of this comes from Hollywood and from the mass media. Unfortunately, the information presented in movies such as Dante's Peak, Volcano, Asteroid, and the newest one, the San Andreas Fault, really shows people acting in ways that they don't normally act in a disaster. Mass panic, mass evacuations, people not helping each other, people fighting over food, things like that. And the media also is looking for sensational news, anything to cover that 24/7 news cycle, and to realistically show a story that will sell newspapers and also advertisement on the 24/7 news channels, right? So, realistically, panic does not occur in most emergency or disaster situations. And a matter of fact, if you saw that article that I posted earlier in the lecture from Amanda Ripley, you're going to have the opposite effect. People will wait and look around to see what other people are doing. Looting, although we do have some looting in cases, for the vast majority of disasters, looting is not common. I mean, we talked about the looting that occurred in Hurricane Katrina, but if you take a look at Hurricane Sandy, that same phenomenon didn't occur. Price gouging is atypical. In the past there may have been some, but normally you don't see that occurring as much as or at all. There's really no documented case law or case studies regarding gouging of gas prices, for instance, in Rita when everybody was trying to leave. And a matter of fact, there were some gas stations that were giving gas for free. Also, price gouging obviously is against the law, so I mean there are those issues that are associated with that. Most people are law-abiding people, right? And then the role of post-abandonment is extremely rare after a disaster. What that means is firefighters and police officers not showing up for work. Now, in California, there has been cases where after an earthquake, there's a 20 to 30% reduction in your people coming in to work from their homes. And that's because in California specifically, that's what I could speak to, is the distance between where people live and work at times. So they can't get through basically due to down bridges and roads. And in some cases, their homes may be directly affected. So that's what we're talking about with that. Shock. Again, shock doesn't really occur amongst the mass majority of victims. You don't see the panic running that you normally would think about. Again, if you look at the Amanda Ripley stories, she talks about the Beverly Hills Dinner Club in Ohio, I believe in Cincinnati, when there was a fire. And people realistically didn't get up and start screaming and running out for the door. Matter of fact, they didn't. Some of them didn't even get up and start going until they're directed to by the waiters and busboys. Reporting is always frequently incorrect. Media gets it wrong. So this is one of those things that you have to do as an emergency manager, is have a relationship with your local media so you can actually give them the accurate information that you want to get out to the public. It's a give and take with the media. They're going to try to get a story. They really are. And you need to be able to direct how that story goes with the correct information. There's a class that I really recommend that you take is Crisis Communication, which really talks about this portion of the of emergency management. In some cases, assistance won't even be needed. People are self-sufficient. There are also volunteer programs that come out. Red Cross, for instance, Team Rubicon, the Salvation Army, some of the faith-based organizations. You won't see people lining up, not necessarily lining up for miles to get that bread and water. They may come and get bread and water or whatever, water specifically, or maybe in some cases ice type things with at points of distribution. But as far as like long-term assistance, it's not as needed as possible. And then the other myth here is martial law. Martial law has never been posed in the United States after disaster. The only time martial law was used was after the Civil War and the Reconstruction down in the South, where they had military governors taking over until they could have elections. So there's that myth that martial law has been imposed. It really hasn't. So exaggerations, right? So let's use the word exaggeration. So flight behavior, people panicking and running. Yeah, people are going to evacuate. They're going to evacuate on orders. Some will self-evacuate before the storm comes. But for the most part, you're not going to see this mass panic of evacuation. Rita was not a self-evacuation. It was directed evacuation. So that started that. Again, theft of property. There is some looting in some cases, but the vast majority of the cases, it's not as big. So you might use this exaggeration of theft of property. The antisocial behavior. I think you're actually going to have a different issue, and we're going to discuss it a little bit in here as well again, but with the unaffiliated, untrained volunteers, and what do you do with these masses of people that come into your city or that are in the city that want to come and help? How do you control them? And that's term that you want to have, because otherwise you're going to have a lot of freelancing going on. So we use programs like such as the community emergency response team programs, your disaster volunteer programs, your medical corps volunteer programs, those type of programs throughout the entire city or county that you're working in. You're going to see, I think you'll see the opposite happening. We already discussed post abandonment. The stunned victims, yeah, they might be a little bit stunned for a little bit, but they're not going to be that person walking around zombie-like, if you will, looking for a direction. You might have one or two people that are in, or a few people that fit that bill, but for the most part, the vast majority of people are going to come in, they're going to do what they need to do, and they're going to start recovery. Again, look at case studies that are out there, and we can look at this, like Sandy's a really good example. Moore, Oklahoma, when those tornadoes went through and ripped up the place, is a really good example. All right, these communities were devastated, yet the people still came out and started helping each other, and they weren't just the stunned victims and the need for assistance. So in reality, people are rational. They understand where they live. They understand the threats that are around there, and they don't wilt to the challenges that are put forth above them. People in general are altruistic, right? They come out and they want to help their neighbors. These are communities. They want to help for the most part. They want to help their neighbors. They want to help their community. They're not all, all every man for themselves. There is a decline in deviant behavior, which is kind of odd, right? I've been on some disasters before where all of a sudden there's no call for services, right, in that area. Responders are overworked. That's a true. That's why we have mutual aid programs and people coming in from across the country to help out. But for the first 72 to 96, maybe first week or two, some of these responders will be working 18-hour days. Victims are not helpless. They do help. They do their own stuff. You'll see people rebuilding right away. Most people that live in hurricane areas know when they're coming, and they start putting up the boards for their homes, and they'll go and they'll clean up the areas on themselves. So that's the deal. Shelters, I've never, and not saying they haven't been, but in my experience, I've never seen a shelter fully utilized. As a matter of fact, the most I've ever seen a shelter used was about 100 people in a 300 person shelter, and that was after the San Diego fires when they had some people coming up, but they were out within a day in a hotel room. Media reports are often inaccurate because they're running with limited information during their 24-hour period. We talked about that a little bit just a minute ago. And there are tons and tons of unwanted donation. And donation management actually becomes a second disaster. Hurricane Andrew, for instance, where people were donated in Florida, this is Florida, where they're donating boxes and boxes of flannel shirts in Florida in the humidity. So think about that, right? What do you do with that stuff? And again, we talked about this again, but I'll just say it again. Martial law is never utilized. So an example, there was no panic at Hurricane in Katrina. Matter of fact, many people didn't leave. Various different reasons why people didn't leave, but they didn't. There was looting, but it was very limited looting in only certain areas, not the entire area. Remember, when we talk about Katrina, everybody always focuses on New Orleans. Katrina was a vast, vast, vast storm which hit multiple states. So yeah, there was some looting in New Orleans, but pretty much that's about it. Most responders fulfilled their duties. There were some people who quit. Some were overwhelmed. Some just, whether their homes were abandoned or their homes were affected. There was some crime, but most people worked together to resolve the disaster concerns. And there are multiple case studies involving that. So, importance of behavior, reporting of so reporting of panicked evacuations that normally don't hurt that don't occur. Then you have the creation of the Homeland Security Advisory System after 9/11. Remember, if you, this keeps changing, but you know, if you remember, like, you know, level red, level yellow, level green. Overburdened law enforcement agencies. Yeah, for a short period of time there will be unnecessary communication, hindering of recovery. Normally that doesn't occur. Unnecessary donations, it really occurs, and an impact on volunteers. You're going to have a lot of volunteers coming out of the woodwork. So basically, Hollywood and the media give inaccurate views of disaster behavior. And research reveals that most people are altruistic and not antisocial after disasters. So you should understand behavior correctly and plan accordingly. And I'm telling you, you need to plan accordingly for all those volunteers that will come out and your mass donations that will come that you're going to have to manage. Anyway, so do the chapter review. Read the book. If you have any questions, you can call me. You have it in the syllabus, or you can email me. You have that in the syllabus as well. All right, and have a great day. Key terms that you need to know: exaggeration, looting, martial law, myth, panic, price gouging, role of post or post-abandonment, and shock. It's copyright notice, 2015, John Wiley & Sons, Incorporated.